Blog Talk Radio.
Society.com, Living Dead Magazine, and Gore Noir. We're going to have quite the interesting show this evening. In our feature interview at 8:30, we're going to have writer, director, and actor Derek Young on to discuss his film Psychotic State, as well as upcoming projects Rednecks, Plan 9, and Deadlines. In about 10 minutes, we're going to have Michael C. Daugherty on, writer-director of Z-Con, and he will be in our indie spotlight. And we will be reviewing Screen Factory's Blu-ray release of Final Exam, and in our first digital dismemberment, we are going to be discussing Derek Young's Psychotic State. Also stay tuned, as we will have several bands featured in our Metal Blade spotlight. But I think we just need to go ahead and get straight into some digital dismemberment.
Digital dismemberment.
And the first film in our digital dismemberment spotlight this evening will, of course, be our guest Derek Young's feature film Psychotic State. The premise is David Coleman, a bipolar 26-year-old man, is one of those people that the world likes to pick on. David is bullied and abused by everyone around him, including his adopted father. When David gets fired from his job after a run-in with a couple of bullies, he loses his medical benefits and stops taking his medication. This causes David to go into a psychotic state, and in a twisted idea of justice, he decides that it is time for him to take out all of his bullies and abusers. The result is a killing spree that ends with a bloodbath beyond reckoning. They should have let David alone. You know, it's really cool. I've known Derek for a couple of years through Facebook, and I was originally supposed to work on this project with him. Unfortunately, the weather and other circumstances prevented me from doing so. So I'm really looking forward to talking to him about several elements of the film. One of the things that I think is really unique about this film is its message, and it really does have an anti-bullying message. Most people would initially look at the film on its opening segment and see the quality of the camera and the lighting work, but I think what people need to realize is I think Derek was shooting for that. It gives the film a little bit more of a gritty and realistic approach. You know, you almost feel like you're watching an exploitation film from the 70s. So the film certainly has that element going for it. I think all of the actors meshed well together, Derek playing the lead role, of course. As an effects artist, one of the things that I found really interesting about it were how they went about some of the effects and how the effects looked on camera. And I have to admit that, in particular, the bathtub scene, they're going to be spoiler alert, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, we're reviewing the film and talking to Derek this evening. But there's certainly a fair share of blood, and the bathtub scene in particular is a scene that held my attention. I thought they did a good job combining all the elements they needed to make that the bloody mess that it should have been. You know, and again, as I spoke on the social statement of the film, you know, one of the things that we look at, you know, today, it's not like it was when I was a kid. You know, if you had a problem with someone or you had a bully, you know, you guys duked it out and it was done. And nowadays, you know, kids can be just as mean and aggressive as adults can. And, you know, with all the advent of social media, you know, Facebook, Twitter, all of those things, you know, there is no break anymore. It's a 24-hour cycle. And I think Derek does a really good job of conveying that with his character. You know, if you wanted to take a twisted moral logic from it, you could say that, you know, the bullies get their comeuppance in the film, and while circumstances were dire for Derek's character in the beginning, you know, by the end of the film, a lot of things have changed, and, you know, you're almost stuck in the quandary of, you know, is this really a bad guy? You know, he does so much other good throughout the film that you're left with that moral dilemma at the end, and it's certainly something you have to watch on its own merits to see and express your own opinion about that. Now, one of the things that I really liked about it, and, you know, it says a lot about Derek as a young filmmaker, there are some amazing cameos in the film. Linnea Quigley, Lloyd Kaufman, David Naughton, Jake the Snake Roberts, Conrad Brooks, Camille Keaton, George Cassana, R.A. Milahoff, T.J. Soles, and a host of others make appearances in the film. A lot of them are PSA announcements both before and after the film, but it still hammered the point home, especially when you look at, you know, some of these names. You know, you look at a bully, you know, and as a horror movie fan, you know, who wouldn't have loved to have R.A. Milahoff come in dressed as Leatherface and take out your bully? Or, you know, pro wrestler Jake the Snake Roberts, you know. Everyone knows I'm a big pro wrestling fan, and the message that Jake had to tell about, you know, his childhood and what he had to endure, you know, it definitely left a very impactful message as well. Now, I will say as well, when I had spoken about the quality of the video, I was watching the film streaming online. So, you know, I'm really interested to see what it looks like on a DVD. I would love to see what kind of special features he may have decided to include as well. I know Derek's very resourceful, and again, you know, Lloyd Kaufman in the beginning was absolutely hysterical. The film at times feels like you're watching elements of a trauma film, but, you know, as I've been known to say before, that is certainly not an offensive statement. You know, I feel like Derek was probably influenced by that a lot as well. Like I said, with a host of people that are on there, the guest cameos, everything, that alone makes it worth seeing. And you know, bullying is a thing that everyone has to deal with. And, you know, yes, this is a horror film, and the film goes to drastic measures. It still says a lot that in this day and age, you can take something like a horror film and the topic of bullying and actually turn it into something that's entertaining. I think Derek has a lot of potential in the future as a director. I am looking forward to talking to him later this evening about the film and some of his upcoming project. Right now, I think the only way you can see it as it is at upcoming film festivals. I do know that there is a convention coming up, and I don't want to spoil that. I will let Derek talk about that himself. But right now, the only way I know you can see it is to see it in a convention. And, you know, as far as I know, it will be distributed. We'll ask Derek all those questions when he comes on in a bit. But definitely worth seeing. I would definitely rate the movie about a 7 because there is a lot of context that goes into the film beyond what you just visually see. So, like I said, at 8:30 when we have Derek on, it should be pretty good. And now we are going to move in to our Indie Spotlight. And in tonight's Indie Spotlight, we are going to be speaking with Michael C. Daughtry, writer-director of Z-Con. So let's go ahead and bring him on. Hello, Michael.
Hey, sir. How are you?
I'm good, here. Man. How are you? Good,
not
good.
Too bad.
Well, you know, I have to admit, I saw the Facebook page for Z-Con, and, you know, being a big zombie movie fan and everything that I am, I had to go check it out. And
thank you.
You know, kind of tell everyone what the premise of the film is and how you came up with the concept.
So the premise is essentially Goonies meets Shaun of the Dead set in a Comic-Con type setting. It's about four teenage kids who have a podcast, and they go to a Comic-Con trying to get an interview with their favorite celebrity, and they get stuck in the middle of the zombie apocalypse. So kind of like a Romero picture, it's kind of a social commentary on how we use technology today.
Right.
But I also am a huge fan of movies like Monster Squad and Goonies back in the day where the kids were portrayed far more intelligent than they are today.
Yes.
So I wanted to kind of give a nod to both genres. And then it's got a little bit of Shaun of the Dead, which is, you know, the normal real world with a completely random, unusual event that takes place in it. It's a little bit extreme. And I kind of came up with it over, we had our first film, which is Browncoat's Redemption. So if you're familiar with Firefly, we got Joss Whedon's permission and did a fan-made sequel to it. And that went on to raise $117,000 for charity.
Excellent.
But thank you. But I traveled around at least twice a month from February to November from 2009 to 2011 to conventions all over the U.S. And in 2009... people dressed as zombies, people kind of kept a really good arm's distance. It was still kind of taboo. And then I watched as time got closer and The Walking Dead got more popular, and then the TV show came out, people got closer and closer to the point that about 2011, at the end of the year, people were taking selfies with people as a zombie. So I thought,
right.
how long would it take at a place like Comic-Con for somebody to realize there was an actual zombie there? With all the cosplay going on and all the people, like, how long would it really take? And then what happens if that location gets closed down and stuck with all the people inside the zombies? So that's kind of where
right.
Z-Con came from.
Now, you're using Kickstarter. Tell us a little bit about how you designed the Kickstarter project and some of the perks that you're offering for people that may donate to it.
We're actually over on Indiegogo. But,
oh, you're on Indiegogo now? Okay, because I'm looking on the Z-Con site.
Oh, the site needs to be updated. It's completely...
Okay.
That's why everything goes to Facebook. So if you go to facebook.com/Z-Con movie, you'll see it. But we've got some pretty cool perks. Like for $15, you get a digital download of movie plus your name in the credits. I'm not sure if you're familiar with Wise A. He's a hip-hop horror artist, but he donated an original track called Infected that has yet to be heard, and you can pick that up for $5. But we've even got some cool things like if you're a fan of TV shows like Face Off and always wanted to learn how to make a zombie, we're doing an exclusive for just 20 people where for $100 they get a 2.5-hour session with our makeup artist on a live stream, and he shows them how to do it live, answers Q&A, and it's an experience that's only going to be offered to a small limited people. And then we have everything in between, like t-shirts and posters and things of that nature.
Nice. Now, one of the other things that I saw on your Facebook page, and, you know, it's pretty cool. I've seen them done here, but tell everyone about the upcoming Z-Con Zombie Prom.
Well, we're trying to have a Zombie Prom May 31st, and that'll be in Southern in Maryland. And the idea is just to get everybody together, and a portion of the proceeds of that will go towards funding the movie. But it's really just a chance to get everybody together and dance, sing, and dress as zombies.
Now you had mentioned briefly comparisons, to the messages in Romero's films and things like that. And you brought up the humor of Shaun of the Dead and Goonies, but are we looking at more of is it going to be more of a comedy, or are we going to get the hardcore, not hardcore gore, but I mean, is this going to be a bloody zombie film with plenty of laughs, or can people expect jumps and frights as well?
This is going to be jumps and frights. What I'm trying to do is this would be an introductory zombie movie, so the kids in this aren't going to be the savvy kind of stuff that we always see in a movie where pick up weapons and automatically fight. They're kind of little nerds, so they run and hide, and wackiness ensues, and zombies do get taken out, but kind of like Shaun of the Dead, it slowly progresses. So by the end of the beginning of the third act, it's just kind of full-on zombie chaos.
Now, you've recently been covered by a couple of the bigger websites. What have you noticed in terms of the publicity and fan buzz about the film?
Everybody's excited for it. I think, this is, when I wrote this back in 2011, it hadn't been kind of an idea that I'd seen before. But since then, there was the novel Night of the Living Trekkies that came out, and then the comic Fanboys vs. Zombies. So I think this is something that's just kind of the perfect blending of both worlds, that people are really, really excited to see a zombie movie take place in a place that they've never seen it, but also kind of puts it in a place that's a little bit scarier, because everybody goes to conventions and there's some taboos that we all know. Like, what happens if con crowd actually created a zombie?
Right. Now, one of the things I saw, and I know you said you need to update the website, but one of the things I was looking across the top was you have something called a Z tracker. Can you kind of tell everyone what the Z-Tracker is about, and are the chips still out there?
The chips are still out there, and what we're doing is every time somebody either contributes or supports the site, they get placed on a map so we can kind of track where the infection is going. But we also have little codes that we'll give out at conventions if they find it and they can answer trivia questions. And those will be like little challenge coins and things they could take away that are special to them.
Now you own your own film company, is that not correct?
We do. We're Big Damn Films.
Kind of tell us about how your studio came together, and now your first film was more sci-fi, but are you guys slanted more towards the sci-fi horror genre than anything else?
No, we're completely open to anything. It's just right now these are the things that we're working on. So it got started because we wanted to make the Firefly fan film Browncoats Redemption, and we needed a production company to do that. And I got very, very lucky and amazing large amount of volunteers to pull this off, ranging from people with zero film experience to people that have worked on major motion pictures. And from there, the production company has just kind of grown. And the big focus is that 100% of our net proceeds go to charity.
Very nice.
We can raise the money to make the movie. We can make the movie. We don't need to go out and make a lot of money, but I'd really like to start creating entertainment that actually does good just beyond the $20 that you pay to see it.
Right.
So, for example, ZCon, the proceeds go to American Red Cross and Kids Need to Read, which was co-founded by Nathan Fillion, and they put books in underprivileged schools. So I want to try to make sure, as a production company, the charities that we select for a film are tied into the film in some way.
I mean, it's nice to see that you're doing charitable work with your art. I mean, it's, there are several other people I've interviewed. Renee Geerlings, who's married to Tyler Maines, does a lot of work with Scares the Care. So, I always find it nice when someone in the industry is, giving back. Now, let me ask you this. You're shooting the film in Maryland, correct?
Correct.
Kind of tell us what the independent film scene's like out there in Maryland.
It's crazy. It's not just Maryland. We have this nice little connection between multiple states, between Virginia, Maryland, and D.C. It's pretty cool. I mean, you got a wide range of stuff going on, from a huge, huge, supporters in this area of the 48-hour film festival. Down in Virginia, you have Johnny Johnson, who is amazing with Darkstone. You have Justin Timpain, who is doing the Ninjas Verse series. So if you're a fan of anything from ninjas fighting zombies to ninjas fighting vampires, you can go check those out. And I'm kind of honored to say that we got Ed Sanchez, who did the Blair Witch, and John Waters, who's done everything from, you know, Crybaby on, in our backyard.
Right.
It's really, really cool. And it's, for me, it's really indie. I love the scene that we have.
I mean, it sounds great. I mean, I'm down in North Carolina, so, you know, I'm down here lurking. I may have to
Well, you got to come up, man.
Yeah, I got to come up and see what the scene's like. Now, what can you tell us about the film in terms of the cast or the crew? You know, do you have any actors picked out? Do you have an effects crew picked out?
So we do. We have our 14 leads picked out who are going to play the kids in our film. There's Noah Summer, there's Noah Chayette, there's Austin Riley, and Georgia May Lively. And they're kind of the core that holds the movie together, and they'll be what you see for about 70 to 80% of the film. We've also got our core team together, ranging from Pal Beal, who's our director of photography, who's worked on everything from I Am Legend to The Incredible Hulk. We've got an amazing sound producer, Tamara Johnson, who's worked on television shows like Modern Family and Back, if you guys remember it, back in the 80s with Max Headroom.
Oh, yes, I remember Max Headroom. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Tamara was the one that actually, I believe, and I can be corrected, but I believe she's responsible for that audio volume where his voice goes up and down randomly. So that was really cool. I kind of geeked out on her when we first met. We've got Katie Most, who's our production designer, and she was just on Lizzie Bennett Diaries, which won an Emmy. So we've got an amazing team. And then we've got Vince Calora leading up our makeup, our team, and we've got an in-house effects team that are taking care of the majority of our stuff. I want to make sure we stay as practical as possible with our film and do as much as we can in camera, because it keeps the budget down, too.
I agree, and as an effects artist, I have to say I appreciate that. I get tired of seeing computers take away jobs from people. It's a shame.
Yeah, well, as an effects artist, you got to come up and work a day on the film.
If we might be able to work something out, I'd love to do that, and I'd love to cover it for Horror Society, so I know that would be a trip to do. Now, of course, you're getting ready to work on this, you know, but is there an ultimate project for you? Is there just something, you know, whether it be a remake or an original project that you're just like, man, that's what I want?
This is it. I'm working on it. Like, this is the one I want to make. I'm kind of digging in my heels, and I want to get this done, which is why we've got to get this Indiegogo campaign as successful as possible.
That is just excellent. Well, man, tell everyone where to go if they want to donate, your Facebook page, if you have Twitter, any kind of info you want to send out for people to go check the film out.
Yeah, on Facebook and Twitter, you can go just look for facebook.com/ZconMovie. That's Z-C-O-N movie. The same thing for Twitter. If they want to go to our current Indiegogo campaign, it is indiegogo.com/projects/Z-Con, and you can check us out right there, or just look for zombies in the search, and we tend to come up on the front page. Or if you just go from our Twitter and Facebook page, I'm sure you'll find the link there. The campaign's going on until June 4th, and currently we're at about 62% funded with 22 days left.
Excellent. Well, man, you know, Michael, thank you for coming on. You know, when you get closer to it, we'll set something up. Maybe I can come up there to Maryland and do something for a day. We'd love to have you on the podcast again. And if you have any more news updates, shoot them over to me, and I'll get them up on horrorsociety.com.
You got it, man. Thank you so much for having me on.
Anytime, man. Anytime. You have a good night.
You too. Good night.
And once again, that was Michael Dotry of the upcoming film ZCon, and maybe the dead man will go up to Maryland for a day and make somebody dead or die on film. I seem to be pretty good at that. Coming up in about 6 minutes, we are going to have our featured guest, Derek Young, on to talk about his film Psychotic State and a couple of other new projects he's got coming up. But first, we're going to go into our first Metal Blade Spotlight for the evening. The name of the band is Satan's Wrath, off of the albums Aeons of Satan's Reign. The song is Lives of the Necromancers. And welcome back to the Calling Hours Horror Podcast on Horror Society Radio. This is your host, the Dead Man, Michael Jones. That was the first band in our Metal Blade Spotlight for the evening. That was Satan's Wrath off of the album Aeons of Satan's Reign. The name of the song was Lives of the Necromancers. We'll have a few more songs coming up a little bit later on in the evening. But first, it is time to get to our feature interview for the evening. This evening we have a young filmmaker out in Virginia, where the Dead Man's from, actually, pretty close. He is here to talk about his movie Psychotic State. We're also going to be touching on Family Property, Backwoods Killing Spree, and Midnight Matinee Psycho, as well as a few other things. Everyone say hello to Derek Young. Derek, how are you this evening?
I'm doing great, man. You know, having Michael on a second ago was a perfect lead-in to this because I don't know if you picked up on it, all right? But my main bully, one of my main bullies from Psychotic State was actually in one of the promo videos at the beginning when Jim Crute attacks him as a zombie and he's wearing a Z-Con T-shirt.
You know what?
And,
You're right.
I did not realize that. Actually, the cool thing is Vince Carrera, who's doing some of the he's going to be doing some of the special effects makeup work for Z-Con, did the bite on the shoulder,
mm-hmm.
and he did the light zombie look for Jim, and then he also, if you remember the one bully in the Coliseum that gets burnt by the lighter,
yes.
He did all the work on his face.
Nice.
So, you know, I got a little bit of attachment to the guys. and that being said, I got something cool I'm going to say. Michael has no clue I'm saying this. I'm doing this because they helped me out, so I'm going to try and help them out. Okay?
All right.
You know, he mentioned on his Indiegogo he's got some awesome perks, right?
Right.
So for the Horror Society listeners only, okay, because they're going to be the only ones to hear this, all right, the first person to go donate $100 to the Z-Con Indiegogo campaign will get an extra perk. I will mail them a copy of my first film and mail them a special screener copy of Psychotic State.
Very nice. I will definitely be putting something up. If someone hasn't done it by the end of the show, I will put something up on the site as well about that.
All they're going to have to do is make the pledge, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Take a screen cap showing they made the pledge and send it to me, and I will make sure to add that perk in for them.
Very nice. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you have a first here on the Calling Hours. Well, before we even get into Psychotic State or anything, man, you know, how's life been? I mean, you know, you're one of the few guys that I talk to that has more credits to his name than I do, just behind the scenes, you know. Actor, writer, sound department, producer, director, effects. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. You know, kind of tell us how you've been and, you know, how you first got involved in filmmaking to begin with.
Well, been doing pretty good. Matter of fact, getting ready to start writing a screenplay for the sequel to my first movie, which was Family Property, Backwoods Killing Spree, and I've already got distribution lined up for it before I even start writing. So that's real cool. Got different projects coming my way. Hopefully everything hits up on a bunch of them. Got a couple cons this year I'm going to be at screening the movie, and you know, it's going to be a lot of fun. Everything's rock and roll. As a matter of fact, the coolest thing, other than the birth of my new son,
congratulations on that,
sometime this month Psychotic State is going to be featured in Hollywood Weekly magazine.
Very nice.
So
tell us how that came
a lot
about.
Of good things happen.
Tell us how that came about. That's a big deal.
Well, that's the cool thing. Hollywood Weekly is actually doing a film festival for the first time this year.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get, if you submit to it, you have to get accepted to be in the magazine first off. They have to look at your film and believe that it's unique enough they want to feature it. If they choose that they want to feature it in the magazine, then you're in the running to be in the film festival, which they are not telling who's in the film festival yet, so I haven't heard about it. But the cool thing is, if it lands in the festival, it'll be screening at the lot in Hollywood.
Very nice.
So, but the festival's, you know, thanks to that, I got accepted to be in the magazine, so they're going to be featuring an article on the movie with a review. And a bunch of cool stuff, you know. So I just can't wait for that to come out.
No, I hear you. That's good news.
I would have essentially made it to Hollywood.
Hey, man, you've gotten closer than some of us. You know, but
yeah,
I mean, good luck with all of that. I certainly hope it makes it into the festival. I certainly think that the film provides, you know, it provides a certain social message that, you know, a lot of shows really aren't hitting on in that type of visceral way. And like I said, we'll get into all of that. Now,
yeah.
One of the other things I know that you have coming up is you have this, you talked about doing cons. You have a con coming up in, I think it was October. Why don't you tell everyone what that con's about and what's, you know, who's going to be there?
Oh, man. I'm going to be at EpicCon in Dayton, Ohio. Now, EpicCon is going to be, to me, it's going to be friggin' amazing, because if you go ahead and hit it up, you'll see the guest list. They're going to have a mini Dark Shadows reunion. They're working on doing a mini Savage Streets reunion. They actually have Bill Moseley, Kane Hodder, R.A. Mihailoff. DJ Trey is actually going to be the MC for the weekend. You know, they have Laureen Landon from Maniac Cop 1 and 2. She's going to be there.
I just interviewed her the other week. Yeah.
Yeah, they're going to have Linnea Quigley there. They have it's actually called EpicCon Geek Fest. And it's called a Geek Fest because this is for any geek, no matter what kind of geek. Whether you're an action geek, a sci-fi geek, a gaming geek, a car geek, a horror geek, it doesn't matter what it is, they've got it lined up. And they're going to have some of the Power Rangers there. For a lot of the girls that were real big fans of Hello Kitty, one of the actresses who actually did the voice for Mimi is going to be there.
No kidding.
Yeah, they're going to have the most conventions have been doing the 1966 Batmobile. You know, the Adam West Batmobile. This one's going to have the Tumblr Batmobile from The Dark Knight Rises. And, you know, they're going to have the Goblin Head. Johnny Johnson's going to be there with Matthew Ewald and Monique Dupree. There's going to be a special screening of Plan 9. They're going to have a couple films from Doug Tate that's going to be screening. They have Camden Toys going to be there. I'm trying to remember the guy's last name. It's drawn. It just blanked on me. Trying to remember. I think it's David Hawkins. He played Jennings in the original Omen. So he's going to be there. You know, it's crazy at what they have going on. Jimmy O and April Burrow from the Chainsaw Sally Show will be there. Debbie Rochon. They're going to have Cleve Hall, the Monster Man, making his first Ohio appearance. They're going to have a couple of the Walking Dead zombies with Sonya Thompson and Larry Mainlin and Savannah Hunt. It's just a stellar lineup.
Incredible.
You know, they have, they're actually going to have a car show, which is very unique. So, you know, they're going to have the antique cars, but they're having a lot of unique vehicles put in as well. There's a van that's going to be there that's painted up in memorial to the Walking Dead, and it's been signed by almost all the manager cast members. So it's going to be on hand for people to be able to see. There, you know, of course, they're doing the film screenings, which Psychotic State's going to be there as well. There's an effects competition that I structured myself, that Cleve Hall and Jimmy O and April Burrell and Sonia Thompson and Larry Mainland's going to be the judges of. And the structuring of it's completely outlined on the site. It's going to be something pretty cool and fun, though. And they're actually doing something real unique. They're working with a charity that helps that's helping people out that have pulmonary fibrosis, which, if you don't know what that is, it's actually just where you have scarring on your lungs, and it's real hard to breathe. You can either get it from pneumonia, you can get it, you know, from many different things. $5 of every ticket sale will go to the charity, and then they're also helping out coats for kids. It's Carl's Coats for Kids, where they raise money to buy coats for kids for winter. So that's real cool. And, it's just pretty sweet.
I like to see that again, you know, that this is involved with a charity and everything is going to a good cause. Now, let me ask you, though, how did you initially get involved with this convention?
I contacted them, and I had, mentioned the movie and wanted to be a part of the guest list, and because several of the guests did cameos for the film.
Mm-hmm.
I started talking to them, and before you know it, the next step I made and went into, I've been helping them book a few guests and doing as much as I can to try and help make it a truly epic weekend. It's been real fun. It's been a challenge trying to put on a promoter hat, per se, and help out with everything because, you know, I've been trying to help them find good films to screen. I've been working on promoting the effects competition to get some great effects artists in. And it's just, you know, some stellar stuff going on, which, by the way, any effects artist would love to be there for the weekend because they have a few guys from Face Off that are going to be there.
Are they part of the competition, or...?
Oh, no, they're not part of the competition. They have their own they're actually, I believe, going to be helping judge the cosplay contest.
Nice.
So they're already on board to judge a contest. So,
okay.
But, they're going to be there as guests for the weekend. I'm sure they're going to have a panel or two on special effects. So, you know, it's just crazy good at everything that's going to be there. You know, it's almost like, I guess the way you would say it is, put yourself in the middle of Willy Wonka's chocolate factory, and that's going to be any geek, you know, standing around, they're going to be happy. I mean, as far as action fans are concerned, Mel Novak's going to be there. He's one of the most well-known, villains in the action world. He's fought everybody from Bruce Lee to Chuck Norris.
Funny you bring up Mel Novak, because I know good old Joe should be listening to the show. Mel is actually the guest on the show next week.
Oh, sweet, sweet, sweet.
Yeah.
I've
been watching a lot of
Joe's
his stuff.
Joe's a great guy. Joe's a great guy, man, and so is Mel. And, you know, Mel, even though he hasn't really, you know, he's done a few horror things, but he hasn't really done major horror things. But when you look in the grand scheme of things, he has over 100 kills on screen.
It's amazing when you think about that as well. I mean, and it's not only that. You know, yeah, he may have only worked on a few horror projects, but look at the wealth of talent that he has worked with. I mean, he's a cult actor, and you know, cult actors are certainly welcome on my show as well because they cross all boundaries and all types of taboos. So, you know, I'm definitely looking forward to having him on next week. But let's talk a little bit about Psychotic State right now, since that is the thing. Why don't you tell everyone first about how you developed the idea for Psychotic State, and then what made you, make the the broad spectrum of the film about the bullying. You know, what was it about bullying in particular that made it the central focus of your film?
Well, that's actually kind of funny, man. It started out as a short film. Mm-hmm. I sat down and I put up a post on Facebook and I said, hey, look, I'm going to do my next project. It's going to be a short film. There's no pay. Who wants to be a part of it? And immediately
how
I had about 200
most
people.
Most great indie films start that way.
Yeah, well, immediately I had about 200 people hit me up. And then I had this feeling. I was like, you know what? This is not going to be a short. It's now going to be a feature. Because I can't turn anybody away, because I learned from Lloyd Kaufman that you can never turn anyone away for your movies, because if you do, it may be the biggest mistake you ever make. Because they may
that.
Be the next big thing. So I started to try and figure out how I was going to turn this small idea I had where I was dealing with bullying into a full-length feature horror. And, I was sitting in my house and I was, you know, before David Hess had passed away, he had been mentoring me a little bit on another project that I haven't got to get to yet because of funding. Because, you know, we're going to need a lot of funding for it the way that it's going to be done. But David had passed away, and I was actually sitting on my couch with my laptop, and I could not think of what to do. And I was like, you know what? I really wish David was here so I could talk to him and play ideas off of him. And so I go on Facebook, and the first thing I see is David Hess's face. And then all of a sudden, it hit me. You need to raise funding for Josie, which is the project he was helping me on. Why not tell the story about her brother and his life and what happened to him outside of getting it taken away from his parents? So that's where I started pulling in the character and start pulling in the ideas and pulling in the whole family that was built around him and the bullies. And, you know, you even hear me mention in one of my psychiatry sessions about my sister Josie, who got taken away and put into a psychiatric ward instead of a group.
Right.
And so, you know, we sit down and we're working on it, and I'm, you know, looking at all of it, and I'm starting to pull everything together, and I'm like, you know, hey, this is turning into something really cool. Well, you know, I came up with the little twist idea that I had about, you know, it's real, just because of the fact that I needed to hone in the anti-bullying message completely, because I knew a lot of people were going to be like, hey, how can you make an anti-bullying slasher film?
Right.
And so what I came up with was getting a bunch of celebrities to do public service announcements against bullying, and getting a short film to put at the beginning that dealt with bullying that had nothing to do with the horror aspect, so that you would get the full feel of the message and so that it could possibly reach out to some of their fans and, you know, let them know exactly how they feel about the situation. So I started putting everything together. And the crazy thing is, what you got to watch was the cut-down theater version.
Right.
This thing grew into such a monster that the director's cut is actually a 3-hour and 27-minute film.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. And that was because the director's cut, I knew I was going to have a director's cut because so many people helped out, and I really didn't want to cut some of those people's things out. You know what I'm
right.
saying? Because everybody put in their own time, their own money, their own effort, their own hard work. So for me, leaving in everything that was, you know, that was there was the only option for the director's cut, so that everybody was able to get a copy of the film with what they actually did in it, because there are so many films that come out where people get their spots cut and they never get to see themselves in the midst of the project.
Right.
And I
your
think
name's
that really
credits,
sucks.
But yeah.
You know, your name's in the credits, but hell, what I did isn't, you know.
That's happened to me once or twice, so, yeah, I understand how that feels.
So my director's cut makes sure everybody is seen, and everybody has their little parts that they did, and, you know, it is a little bit lengthy, but it still works. Actually, as a matter of fact, the director's cut is what got chosen to be in MonsterCon in South Carolina, in Greenville, South Carolina. And I sent that in, and it ended up beating out a handful of other films getting into the film festival.
Nice.
That director's cut. And when I made the decision for them to not screen the director's cut, screen the version that you have, you know, we put out there to the fans that that was what's happening, and I actually had people write me, well, am I going to be able to buy the director's cut? Because that's what I want to see.
Yeah. I hear it. Well, since you're talking along those lines, and we'll get to some of the other finer points, but, you know, what are you looking at doing for distribution? Are you looking to have a company pick it up? Are you looking at VOD? I mean, what's the plan?
Well, actually, right now, it's sitting with 10 distribution companies. They're all debating on, you know, everybody's having to look it over. I'm sure they're probably looking it over a couple times, especially, you know, me putting forth, I'm starting to throw forth all this promotion that I'm doing to show that there will be a market for it because I'm building it without them having to do a thing. All right. So I've got hopes that they're going to come back. I'm going to at least get one of them to come back with a deal. Because, you know, I've seen how many times each one of them's watched it and what they're looking over. So, I'm hoping I get a bite soon. But the whole thing, I know I've got a couple smaller companies that I can go with, without any worry about it, but I'm not wanting to go with the smaller companies. I'm wanting to go with a bigger company. So I'm going to wait to see what all those guys say, and then I'll turn to the smaller company with it if I don't get into one of the bigger companies. But, you know, it's...
Well, one of the things that people are going to ask, especially when they see the movie, is first of all, you have an amazing amount of cameo appearances for the PSA announcements that are both before and after the film. I mean, you know, Linnea Quigley... Lloyd Kaufman, I thought, his bit was hysterical. I mean, I almost wished you guys hadn't beeped any of it out because that was just funny.
Well, no, that's actually the way that it was done. it was done that way on purpose, and as a matter of fact, it's a YouTube video that Troma put up, but Lloyd Kaufman gave me the rights to use it for the public service announcements because that's what it was about.
Right.
It's kind of showcasing how... You know, how people can actually be bullies without even thinking they are, you know. And every one of those sections, you go watch it on YouTube, it's set up the exact same way. They did that on purpose. That's how they gave me the video, so that's the way that it is.
I hear it. You know, and then, you know, we also had David Naughton, Conrad Brooks, Camille Keaton, R.A. Milhoff, P.J. Souls. But I'll tell you, you know, the one that struck me the most, and, you know, like I said, fans of the show know that I'm a big pro wrestling fan. There were two in particular that stuck out to me. The first one was Jake the Snake Roberts. You know, being a big wrestling fan and, you know, knowing the things that he's gone through in his life and how his childhood was, you know, it was very sad to hear, you know, him speak about it. But at the same time, you know, how empowering it. Here's a man that in the prime of his career, you know, had 80,000 fans screaming for him at WrestleMania. You know what I mean? So even a man that went on that was that successful early in his life suffered, you know, that kind of abuse and that kind of torment. You know, how was it, you know, emotionally, you know, with someone like hearing Jake Roberts' story for the PSA?
Well, the crazy thing about that, man, is at that it was saddening to hear it, but at the moment I just had this feeling that he was giving me a piece of gold.
Right.
Because it, in all honesty, it was kind of funny how it happened, you know. DDP was actually going to be, wasn't going to, you know, he was supposed to be at this convention that I was going to be at, and he was going to do a video for me, but then he ended up having to cancel for work purposes. So I gave him a call, and I was like, dude, do me a favor. Since you can't do the video, since you're not going to be there, tell Jake about me so that when I go up and talk to him, everything will be cool. And Paige, you know, obliged me, told Jake when I got there, I walked up to him and talked to him, and he said, yeah, man, we'll do the video, no problem. So I was standing out. I was standing out in front of the convention center in Charlotte, North Carolina, because I actually filmed it at Mad Monster Party.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm standing out in front of the convention center talking to a couple of guys that were recently married, and these guys were huge Troma fans. And you know, so I was, and I, you know, I just had a vibe from them that they were probably Troma fans. So I started talking to them, and I was like, you know what? I just got a feeling you're Troma fans. I was like, dude, let me tell you about my movies. Well, in the midst of me telling them, you know, I had my camera because I was going around doing stuff, and in the midst of me telling them, out come Jake to get a cigarette. Well, when Jake came out, he looked at me, and he said, oh, good, you got your camera. You going to do this fucking video or what? And I was like, yeah, we can do it. And he had done made friends with these two guys, and he looked at me, and he actually... It was funny because here we are doing a PSA against bullying, and here he is talking about not being a bully anymore. And it was quite funny because he actually bullied me into making the video what he wanted. Because he looked at me and he said, well, if we're going to do this damn thing, these two guys right here are going to be in it. I was like, okay.
That's Jake's
style. Which in the shorter version, I had to cut out what they were saying just to get down to a certain time length because I had nothing else I could cut.
Right.
And I was trying not to, but I needed to get to that certain sweet spot, so I had to. But it's in the director's cut, you know, everything that they had to say. But there's actually a point where you saw the guys, more than likely, and Jake comes up and he puts his arm around the shoulders and he's like, you know, I trust you two more than I do that motherfucker behind the camera.
Right.
And it was beautiful. But what was even funnier was we had cut off the camera before they were talking, and he actually looked at them and said, you guys want to tell... He actually looked at them. He said, you want to tell them what you think about what I just said, right? And they were like, yeah. So then he smacks me on the back, and he says, turn that fucking camera on, because they're going to tell you what they thought about what I had to say, and you're going to film it, and it's going to be in your movie somewhere. I was like, all right, Jake, you got it, brother.
Well, no one wants a DDT.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm sitting here, you know, filming what they had to say, and he come up and said that, and I just started laughing my ass off. I was like, man, I fucking love you, Jake. That was a piece of gold. And but he gets into telling everything, and I thought it was very, you know, very funny at the end how he basically bullied the bullies. You know, because at the very end of it, he basically tells everybody, look, stop the bullying, stop the bullshit, and stop the hate, or I'll find your ass. And it's
classic.
Like classic Jake the Snake, beautifully done. And, you know, we actually filmed their thoughts after he said everything, but I ended up putting their thoughts before he said anything. So, you know, in the director's cut, because I thought it played off better to have him come up and say he trusted them more than he did the motherfucker behind the camera before he talked, you know. So, but it was just amazing, man, to be able to just have everybody, you know, that I sat down and talked to say they wanted to get this message out and they wanted to be a part of the project. Which, you know, some people are hating on it because of the way I did it, you know, saying that all I do is go around gaining cameos at conventions to slap with my movies in order to try and sell them. But that's not the truth. The only reason I got the cameos was to help reach out to their fans and spread the word about bullying. And what's quite funny is there's actually, I know you probably haven't seen it yet, but if you go on YouTube,
mm-hmm.
I have one public service announcement that I got at Mad Monster Party that I could not put in the movie because he's such a big name that, you know, he was like, you know, I don't want it to be in the movie because you'll be selling it off of, you know, you'd be selling your movie off my name.
Right.
He said, but I'll tell you what, I'll give you a 2-year contract to have it on the Facebook page for, I mean, on the YouTube page for the movie.
Nice.
So if you go on YouTube and you type in Danny Glover PSA video, you'll be able to watch what he did.
Very nice.
So, it's indirect, you know, it's kind of indirectly linked to the movie. So
now you kind of brought up one of the points that I would find that critics may come across or come on you at is, you know, how your character responded with violence after the years of bullying, because the film is certainly graphic in a lot of the murders and stuff. I had mentioned before during the review that in particular the bathtub scene was a favorite of mine. I was really entranced with how well the slit throat was done, the spurting of the blood. That's, you know, just the effects artist in me. But,
you know,
with it being a horror film, and, you know, horror films have a way of, you know, amplifying the terror, you know, the evil that's being done, you know, I kind of saw the character that you played as, you know, a conflicted character for sure. I would never go so far as to say he's a bad guy, because he certainly did try to do a lot of good in the film as well, you know, except for when he went into his psychotic states. You know, what do you say to the critics who might complain about the level of violence and how your character went about exacting his revenge?
Oh, well, the thing I need to say to those critics is watch my video immediately after the film.
Right.
I do my own PSA where I come out and tell you, look, I don't condone this. I'm just showing something that actually has happened from bullying. Somebody snaps out, kills a shitload of people. He may not become a serial killer, but it happens, you know. And why cover that? Why not show it? We even touch base in the short film about the suicide part, where you're watching the kid holding the pills getting ready to commit suicide. I mean, it's just giving every horrific aspect of what happens from bullying. Why turn it down? Why tone it down to try and make everybody feel better about themselves, you know?
Right.
This is truly something that happens. I don't condone anybody going out and doing what my character did. But, you know, at the same time, I want everybody to realize that this happens. And sometimes we're so quick to judge those that do this without finding out what they have been through in life. And honestly, I believe people that do end up snapping because of bullying and committing murders and everything do not deserve to be put in a penitentiary for the rest of their life. They should just be put into a psychiatric ward and taken care of properly, because, you know, in all reality, society as its whole is what pushed them to that point. You know, you can only turn around and walk away so many times before you snap and make a very bad decision. And I don't think you should be punished with life in prison with people that just methodically thought out and planned killing somebody over drug money or over something stupid, you know, when this person, when some of these people spend years of mental and physical abuse at the hands of bullies.
How much real-life research went into Psychotic State? You know, you kind of mentioned rage killers, you know. Did you look at stuff like shooting at Columbine? Did you look at cases like the, what was it?
Well,
the
crazy thing
kids?
Is, the crazy thing is, I've actually suffered from bullying since I was 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So every time I've seen anything like that happen, that's the first thing that triggers in my head. And I always look into it, because it's like, did they have something else going on? Yeah, they didn't just snap and go out and decide to do this one day because they wanted to be famous, you know?
Right.
I mean, something wasn't triggering in their head right, and what is it that made it that way? Because I know, like myself, I'm bipolar. I've gotten a thick skin, though, to where I've been able to turn the cheek and walk away, you know, because I've had so much put at me. To be honest, in my time alive, because I just turned 30 this year, in the 30 years I've been alive, I've had a gun pulled on me at least 10 times. I've been stabbed twice. I've been on my deathbed 3 times. I've been jumped more times than I can count, and I've had bosses who run over top of me every time I turn around just because they realize I'm a nice guy who will do whatever it takes to keep my job.
Well,
you
I
know,
understand
so,
that. Yeah.
So I've basically lived a lot of the scenarios that happened in the movie with what people did to him were things that happened to me. Christine, the girl that kind of ruined his life in high school when he asked her to the dance. I had a girl that way. I went and asked her to the dance, and the first thing that came out of her mouth was, "Hey, you're a cool person to talk to every now and then and be a friend with, but I can't be seen going on a date with you because it will ruin my reputation." And they actually went around after that and told everybody that I asked them. They didn't have to, but they went ahead and did it, and I ended up becoming the butt end of the joke for at least 6 months. You know?
Right.
The one thing at the field party, the massive scene at the end, you'll notice, is his girlfriend goes off and he catches her sleeping with one of his so-called friends. And, my 18th birthday party, I had that happen to me. I was throwing a big-ass shindig. We had about $3,000 worth of liquor. We're out in the middle of the country partying. I'm sitting looking for my girlfriend, and I walk in, and I stumble into a room, and there she is, banging one of my friends.
Oh, man.
So, I mean, you know, I've had all of these different things happen to just keep on beating on me, but instead of letting it do what it does to some people, I decide to take it, turn it around, and use it in a positive light, and use it towards my creativity, which really is the biggest part of the message from this is instead of going to suicide or instead of going into murder, take your experiences and turn them around and use that to make yourself better than anybody ever expected you to be. So then you can basically say, "Ha, I told you, I was more than you thought I would be."
Why do you think it's genres like horror that can touch on a taboo subject like this, like bullying? You know, because there are a lot of taboos associated with it, you know. You know, as men, we're told, you know, think about it. We're told as men that, you know, we need to act a certain way. You know, we need to do this. We need to do that. You know, and then on the same token, you know, a lot like you, I don't believe that violence is necessary until it becomes, you know, there's just
necessary.
No other way. You know,
why
is it that our genre is the one that can put it to film? And granted, in the beginning, critics will crucify our genre over it, but then, you know, a Spielberg or someone will pick it up and do just about the exact same thing, but they're praised for it. Why do you think that is?
Okay, well, here's the thing. When it comes to independence, we're always shit upon by any of the bigger venues because they want to keep control and they don't want us to take over what they've supposedly just built by themselves when, in all reality, indie filmmakers built Hollywood. You know?
Right.
But the thing with our genre is taboo. That's the reason we can introduce stuff like this because we are not the norm. We're not a romantic comedy. We're not an action flick. You know, we are not a comedy, period. You know, we are everything in life that is horrible. That's why we are horror. Whether it scares you or whether it just completely hits home with you so much that it's insane, that's what makes horror great. I mean, you got to think like back at Last House on the Left. The original with David Hess. People crucified Wes Craven for that movie. They said he would never work in the industry again because it was so realistic and it hit home so hard and it got banned from so many countries. Well, we see how wrong they were with that, you know. So,
and let's not forget, too, that attached as a producer on that film was Sean Cunningham, who went on to do the Friday the 13th series as well.
Exactly. I mean, you know, it's... You take chances in life, And a lot of times, realistic films bring home more than anything else because the realistic films are what people can connect with.
Right.
Anybody that has suffered from bullying is going to watch this. They're going to be jumping through the roof when they see the bullies die. They're going to be sad when they see the guy beaten, you know. It's going to be something that's going to touch base with everybody that has ever been through bullying. And then the bullies themselves, it's going to smack them in the face with, hey, look, you don't want to fuck with the wrong person because you do not know what might happen in the end.
Right.
You know,
it's a valid point. Now, you know, you, of course, mentioned, you know, David Hess being, you know, your mentor. You know, Last House on the Left has come up a couple of times. You know, one of the things that I took away from the film, and I've noticed that several other people that have reviewed the film have also thought that the film has a very gritty, almost exploitive look to it. Was it always a conscious decision to stylistically make it like a 70s grindhouse film?
That's kind of funny, man. I never set out intending to make movies that way. They just end up that way. I think my films tell me where I need to go as a filmmaker because I'm still learning.
Right.
And, I mean, to be honest, my second film, Stiff Magazine, when they did a review on it, they actually compared my film to Quentin Tarantino and Robert Rodriguez's Grindhouse series, talking about how they had to clean it up so much in order to get it in the theaters and how it left fans wondering what it would be like if a filmmaker actually brought out a true grindhouse raw film in today's market. And then they finished off the statement with director Derek Young answered that with Midnight Matinee Psycho. So, you know, it's something I never really set out on, but I kind of had a feeling that when I started doing movies that I may end up going that way because those are my favorite style of film. Tarantino and Rodriguez are some of my favorite directors. And when I got into horror, the first film I watched was Last House on the Left. So it kind of, you know, the
influence
film for me was its best from the 60s to the 80s, you know,
right.
Late 50s all the way up till like mid to late 80s. That's when film was at its best and at its peak. You know, I mean, you couldn't go to the box office without having a hard decision on what movie you wanted to watch. You know, just because they had so many great movies. Now you go to the box office and you look at everything they got and you're like, well, there's one movie that might be worth watching. The rest of them, I don't give a shit. I'll get it later when it comes on Netflix. You know?
And, oh, I feel you.
I mean, it's just sad that it's gotten that way. But, you know, it's what happens. But, you know, I never answered your question about what got me into filmmaking. And,
yes, what did get you into filmmaking?
Well, I had a friend who was studying everything he could on his own to become a filmmaker. And me and his brother actually acted in a bunch of short films with him. And we even tried to do a little knockoff on the Jackass series with this thing on MySpace we put up called Lame-O Videos. And we would just do lame-ass videos, make them as lame as possible, just for the hell of it. And he got into finally writing the scripts that he wanted to do. And he'd come to me with different ones, got me to type them up, got me to cast them, get locations, get ready to shoot, and then he would cancel. It's going to be raining, we can't do this. It's going to be this. Well, I don't think we can pull it off with his nerves. You know, he was really worried about if we could make it happen or not. So the last time he canceled, the last time he told me to cancel, I had this great location. I had a great cast lineup, and I was like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm just going to write a movie, and we're going to do it. So I did Family Property back with Killing Spree, and when I got done with it, I lost him as a friend. Really, I was just trying to show him if I can pull this off on my own, we can pull it off together, you know. But he took it the wrong way. We haven't been friends since. But, you know, shit happens. I've moved on, and from what I understand, he's finally making his first film out of Arizona. So, you know, I got to give him props for that. But it's, you know, if I would have waited for him, I would still be here today waiting. I started in 2008 by doing that, and I haven't stopped since. So, you know, it's...
What would you say was the most important thing you took away from your experiences on that film?
God, let's see. The most important thing I took away from it was pay close attention to your damn microphones. Because I had never ran sound. I had never done anything. I just went out and did it, you know?
Right.
And I had a microphone I had plugged into the camera, and, you know, it was working fine. I had no clue at all that it was having points where it wasn't picking up because it was the mic was shorting out. And
oh, man.
So then I had to go in and dub a bunch of shit and had to do all this, and it's like, I ended up having a huge headache because there was no way I could refilm any of it because I didn't have any budget for it, you know. So, you know, hey. Also, I learned I need to really watch microphones going into the shots.
Oh, yeah.
Because the guy holding the mic threw them in, and at the time I didn't know how to crop the shots, so I just left it in. And when I saw all of the problems I had, I knew that I would not be able to make a even decent movie out of it. I was like, well, let's go for the worst movie. And as a matter of fact, well, you know, as a matter of fact, the distribution company that picked it up, Worldwide Multimedia, God love them, they went ahead and marketed it and heralded it as the worst movie ever made. And to be honest, I actually believe I've gotten it, because if you go on Rotten Tomatoes and you look, you know, at their rating system, according to how many good reviews the movie, it's based on how many good reviews the movie gets. Well, Plan 9 from Outer Space, it has a 13% good critic rating, all right? And it's held the title since 1959. Well, Troll 2 has a 0%, right?
Oh, how do people hate Troll 2, man?
I don't know. I love it. But here's the thing. Family Property Backwards Killing Spree has been on Rotten Tomatoes since October, and it has not got even one fucking review, bad or good. Nobody's even taken the time to review the damn movie. So, that being said, right now, I'm the only movie on Rotten Tomatoes that has no critic reviews. So
I
actually
have to
think
it
I'm the worst movie.
I'm going to have to review it.
I think I'm, well, I don't know, because I don't know if I want you to or not, because you might actually like it. And then I'm going to be shit out of luck. I'm going to have a good rating.
You have the highest rated film on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah.
Well, since you
one
brought,
review,
since you brought
so that's
that
100%.
Since you brought that up, you know, about Plan 9 being one of the worst movies of all time, tell us about your role in the remake, Plan 9, where you play a zombie.
Well, yeah, you know, it's a small role. But, you know, I'm very proud of it because I'm a huge Plan 9 from Outer Space fan. I'm a huge John Johnson and Darkstone Entertainment fan. So being able to just be on set with Johnny was like one of the biggest perks in the world because he is amazing as a filmmaker, and he doesn't have a problem giving advice. So he was, you know, on other projects that he worked on, I actually was able to get some advice from him on different things to help me learn, you know. But it's just, you know, even though it's a small zombie spot where I'm not really on screen, but maybe just a few seconds, you know, I'm actually one of the very last zombies that you see alive. So, you know, I'm right at the ending of the movie, and, you know, I've been helping Johnny promote the hell out of the thing, and, because I'm just very proud of it, because I sat down and I didn't know what to expect when we went to the cast crew screening. I had no clue how the film was going to be like, but I knew he was trying to do a serious version of it, and but have comedy in it and everything else. And oh my God, man, when you if you come to EpicCon and you get to see Plan 9, you're going to flip. You're going to be screaming to the high heavens to the fans about this movie, because he uses every style of filmmaking from like the 40s on, dude. I mean, like, whenever he's hitting every era of filmmaking, and he has so many great effects in it. His wife, Mariah Johnson from BioDuck Effects, she does the effects in it, and it is, you know, he made sure to throw in so many things that came from the original film to pay homage to it, and he stretched the story and put it into this huge extent, and it is amazing. I mean, literally, the cast and crew and some of the members of the public that got to watch it for the first screening, everybody literally, out of appreciation for how good the film was, jumped to their feet in a round of applause, screaming and hooting and hollering at how great it was. And he had a screening at a convention here locally in Roanoke called Mysticon. Same thing happened. The room was packed full of people, and at the end of it, everybody was cheering. And, I mean, it's just, you know, I don't want to give it a huge amount of hype, but what I can say about, because I hate to hype films up so much that they don't meet the potential. You know what I mean? But he did Ed Wood justice.
That's good to hear. I'm looking forward to seeing it myself. Now, let me ask you about this. Your second film, which you actually reference in Psychotic State, tell us a little bit about Midnight Matinee Psycho.
Well, the funny thing is, I don't know if you caught it, but both of my movies were referenced in Psychotic State.
I definitely heard the Midnight Matinee Psycho.
Well, Eric Morris, who's writing the Psychotic State novel, actually did a cameo as a news broadcaster, and in that, he mentions the family property murders. So there's a small mention to it, not a lot. You know, you wouldn't catch that it was a movie. You know what I'm saying? But we did make mention to it. And but with Midnight Matinee Psycho, man, it was just awesome to work on, because, which by the way, it comes out July 22nd.
Very good.
So you know, I've landed distribution with it, and it's going to be coming out. But it is just amazing at what happened with it, because I ended up doing some reunions that blew me away, 30-year reunions, right?
Right.
I had Victor Miller, the writer and creator of Friday the 13th, actually play one of my news broadcasters that breaks in the middle of the movie and tells what's been happening in the film, you know? And I ended up getting Ari Lehman, the first Jason Voorhees, to do a small cameo spot in a convention. I have an 11-minute convention scene where one of the main characters is actually an indie filmmaker, and he is at the Days of the Dead convention in Indianapolis promoting his first film, Family Property. And while he's promoting it, some of the big names in horror come by and welcome him into the horror family. You know, that includes P.J. Souls and Ari Lehman, and I had Sal the Vampire Santa come through. And but I ended up doing that 30-year reunion between Ari and Victor. I was able to put them in, you know, on screen together for the first time since Friday the 13th. Which was amazing. And then I went even deeper, and I got a return to screen from Jimmy Steele, whose real name's Tom Candela. If you've ever watched Madman, he played Richie.
Okay.
The teenage kid that called out Madman Mars and started the murders. Anyhow, I got his return to screen appearance, and he plays the lead character's buddy who ends up going online and becoming a minister in order to wed his friend and his new bride, which is hilarious as hell, you know, because he's doing the wedding and he says, thanks to the state of Virginia and 5MinuteWeddings.com, I now pronounce you man and wife. You know, so it's some, you know, it's some little funny anecdotes in it. I ended up getting Paul Madman Mars Ehlers to do the special introduction for the film. So I put Madman Mars and Richie on screen together for the first time in 30 years.
Wow.
You know, then when you throw in PJ Souls and Mike Holman and Mike Christopher from Dawn of the Dead, and you throw in Sal Lizard, and, you know, I had a nice little cameo set up there. And I had Eric Morris in it. And with every one of my movies, I've got Boyd Kaufman attached to them. He's been attached to all three of my films, and I'm proud to say that. Even though Troma wasn't going to be distributing family property, Lloyd allowed me to share his table with him at Horror Hound in Cincy. And it was amazing to me because here I am sitting on the edge of the Troma table with all of Troma's films, me with family property in this one little slot, nobody knowing who I am or why I'm even fucking sitting there. And Lloyd would have a line full of people, and he would always look, and nobody would be talking to me, and he would look up, and he would stop everybody and say, before I sign a damn thing else, when I get done, I want you to turn around and walk to the end of the table and talk to Derek Young, because he's the future of Troma.
Nice. That's an endorsement if I ever heard one.
And that actually led to me meeting Andrew Seymour, who did a lot of the cinematography for Psychotic State, and Michael West, who actually did the where I cut off the bully's hands, and he did the where I stabbed the girl in the throat with the scissors, and he did a few other effects for the movie. And they were both brothers that came up to me, thanks to Lloyd saying that, and we got to talking, and they wanted to break into the industry. And then when I started doing this movie, the first thing I did was contact them and say, hey, it's time you break into the industry.
Nice.
So I got them to come down and be a part of it. And as a matter of fact, I think they're going to be helping Jonathan Moody with his new film, Sasquatch versus the Yeti. And then there's you know, a whole lot of work they got going for them.
Well, tell us, because we're getting here near the end, but what can you tell us about these two other projects on your IMDb, Rednecks and Deadlines?
All right, well, Deadlines is done by Tracy Lee Stanton. She actually got Camille Keaton to be a part of it. It's a great film about an outsider who comes in, and he's not what he seems to be. He's very demonic. He's actually somewhat... it's kind of got somewhat of a paranormal feel. I mean, it's got some great, great effects work. John Johnson actually ran the camera for that. But Tracy Lee Stanton, she actually wrote it and produced it. And my buddy John Angel, who made Rednecks, he's part of that as well. And we actually played in Deadlines. We brought back a couple characters that we had that me and John Angel played in The Vampires of Zanzibar, Marcus and Rakeed.
Mm-hmm.
We're two high school wannabe rappers, thugs. And everybody loved our characters so much, people keep asking us to bring those characters into films. So we ended up putting them in Deadlines. And it's real awesome. We got a scene where Matthew Ewald's a part of it, and it was just stellar stuff. And then Rednecks, I'm not in it a vast amount. I played the sheriff that's actually in the opening portion of the film. But Rednecks is actually a comedy musical that speaks about the trials and tribulations of not only making it to where you want to be, but the fight between good and evil inside of yourself. And, you know, it's a bunch of rednecks who end up making a deal with the devil, and they become famous and end up turning into rap and all kinds of shit. It's completely crazy, psychotic out there, but that's John Angel for you. If you go on YouTube, you can actually watch his movie The Vampires of Zanzibar, which is fucking hilarious. That kind of gives you the feel of the Rocky Horror Picture Show, but he's just got a piece of genius to him, and Rednecks is far from anything but genius as well. It's completely hilarious. There's just so much in the way of all of that. I want to make sure, before I go, though, I want to make sure to throw a shout-out to Michael Barber of Dark Fantasy Creations. He actually did that throat slit that you were talking about, and he did all of the work at the field, like almost all of the field party deaths, and he did the beer bottle death scene.
He did a fantastic job. I mean, kudos to those effects. I was very impressed.
Well, I got him on, and then I also want to throw a mention out to the film company that I actually signed on with last year, Asphyxiated Films. We got a lot of stuff getting ready to happen with those guys as well that I'm going to be a part of. So, you know, I got to make sure that I give them their props. They helped me get a lot of my cast members. Jenny Giannetti, who happened to be the main stripper that you saw that did the lap dance on the couch. That,
right.
I'm pretty sure you thoroughly enjoyed
it. It wasn't bad.
Well, you know, so, but thank God for her coming on, because the other girls had no musicality whatsoever, and we had shot that scene the first time, and it looked like complete and utter shit, and she gave them a crash course on dancing, and I was able to get some good stuff. So, you know, I got to throw her props, too, because she helped out a lot. And to be honest, a lot of the still photography was done by a lot of the cast members, because they're all still photographers. You know, they were still photographers, too. Mew Gomez and Crystal Howell. And actually, I did something real cool. One of my fans that I've made on the way of the convention circuit, she brought her family down, and they all acted in the movie, had little small spots. But her name's Lucy Martin Rogers. She come down, and her whole family came down for the first weekend of shooting and was a part of it. Her son actually played one of the redneck bullies, and she did some lighting and photography for us. So I got to give her thanks for that, too, because she stepped from the fan world into a friend world and became a part of the project. So, you know, that was real awesome. And, you know, it's just stellar stuff, man. I've been so glad to be a part of all of it. But I want to make sure to mention, too, if you like off-the-wall baseball films,
mm-hmm.
All right, that have nothing to do about fucking baseball. I was in a movie called Reunion 108, where it's mostly sitting in the clubhouse, and the guys are telling stories from the road while they're getting ready for their reunion game. So it's mostly crazy stories that happen on the road, and you don't see a lot of baseball, but I got to actually be in one of the baseball scenes where I'm in a flashback from an 80s baseball game, and the guy that made it played for the Braves and the Yankees back in the 80s, and he...
You there? Well, it looks like Derek has dropped off. Derek, you know, again, I want to thank you for coming on. You're always welcome to come on to the show. If you ever have any news about any of your projects, definitely let me know. Everyone make sure to check out Psychotic State. Head on over to his Facebook page. or to IMDb to check out more of the details on who is available. But coming up next, we're going to have our second song in our Metal Blade Spotlight. We are going to have Amon Amarth. The name of the CD is Deceiver of the Gods, and the name of the song is Under Siege.
We'll be right back.
And welcome back to the Calling Hours Horror Podcast on Horror Society Radio. This is your host, the Dead Man, Michael Jones. That was the second song in our Metal Blade Spotlight for the evening. The name of the band was Amon Amarth. The name of the CD was Deceiver of the Gods, and the song was Under Siege. Coming up here in a minute, we are going to get to what my friend Mitch has been waiting for all evening long, and that is the Scream Factory Blu-ray release review of Final Exam. So I think we should just get right into digital dismemberment.
Digital dismemberment.
And in our final segment of the evening, we are going to be reviewing Scream Factory's release of the 1981 film Final Exam by Jimmy Houston. If you all remember last week, I told you this was released actually today on DVD. Came out the same time as Evil Speak, which we reviewed last week, of course. To give you some info on Final Exam. At Lanier College, the semester is almost over. Exam week is coming to a close when some upperclassmen play a prank by staging a phony terrorist attack. But the next moment of excitement at school won't be a prank, and it's something a lot more final than an exam. Students are falling prey to a knife-wielding maniac stalking the school, bent on making sure that for some, school is out. Forever. Interesting film, to say the least. Mitch and I sat down to watch this the other night, and there's some good, there's some bad. Unfortunately, the bad kind of outweighs the good on this one. This is a good movie in terms of if you want to see what the cookie-cutter parts are of making a slasher film, the film certainly has each one of those elements. Unfortunately, with in my opinion, the way it was scripted, you know, they're very heavy-handed. It's you know, the cliche sticking out a little bit too much. You know, you have your jocks, you have your nerds, you have, you know, the cute virgin girl, you know, you have the girls that sleep around. You know, you have all of that. But what you are missing out of this one, which kind of takes it out of context from normal early 80s slasher films, there is one scene of nudity, but it is noted that the director has stated that the nudity was for the trailer to get a hook. Other than that, there isn't no real nudity in the film. You have some blood, but I mean, as far as a horror slasher goes, you certainly don't have the copious amounts like we were used to seeing in the early 80s. You know, the film is certainly not what you would consider a Savini masterpiece in terms of effects, or Rick Baker, or anyone along those lines. Again, I think as a film study, the film does, you know, it is structured to the point where they give enough backstory that to an extent you care about the characters, but for the most part, most of the characters are so over the top, and at least in my viewpoint, that you kind of want to see some of them die, unfortunately. You know, is it the worst horror film I've ever seen? No, it's not far from it. Now, let that be said, that is no reflection on Scream Factory. Scream Factory simply released the product. And to speak to that, the special features included on the disc include a new HD transfer from the original camera negative. There is audio commentary with cast members Joel Rice, Cecile Baghdadi, and Sherry Willis Birch. There are also interviews with said cast members as well as the theatrical trailer. It is a 1080p high-definition widescreen, 1.78.1 DTS HD Master Audio Mono. It does have a runtime of 94 minutes. As it goes without saying, and always a bonus to Scream Factory, is the fact that the transfer looks beautiful. They have an unretouched version of the trailer on there as the feature, and it's very grainy, very fuzzy in a lot of aspects. And I have to admit, watching the film, the one thing I was struck by extremely much so was the fact that...
Hello?
It looked good. So, is this Mitch?
Oh, this isn't Mitch. This is actually Greg Titterington from Psychotic State.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, yeah. I saw it, that you were interviewing Derek Young. I guess, did you already interview him?
Yes, yes. He was on earlier. He was on from 8:30 till 9:30.
Yeah, I played his friend who was trying to get him to move with me because of his abusive father.
Oh, okay. Well, how are you doing this evening?
I'm doing okay. Yeah, I'm looking forward for, you know, I guess there's going to be some exciting things coming up with that film.
Yes, I'm very excited. He told me about the con coming up, and, you know, I think the film was a very well-done film. Like I said, I've known Derek for a couple of years on Facebook, and I was more than excited to help cover him. What would you like to say real quick about working with him on the film?
Oh, it was great. I actually shot my film here in Vancouver because he lives in Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
So the one who played my sister, her and I were both in the movie They Came from the Attic, and that's going to be out worldwide soon, I think. And it's distributed by Lionsgate in the UK, that's for sure, on DVD. And so also I'm going to be working with Derek in his upcoming films, too, a sequel to Family Property, as well as his film Josie. I plan to go down to Virginia to be in that one. So, yeah.
Well, I definitely think he's a face to watch coming up in the industry. So, you know, what was it that gravitated you towards the film? You know, what made you think, oh, man, I got to work with Derek?
Well, actually, I was doing a podcast show like you were, and still am, for Racks and Razors, and Derek was a new coming filmmaker with Family Property, so we interviewed him, and so then after that, I worked with him, Derek, and the rest is history.
Well, I mean,
so,
I wish you could have called in earlier. We're right here at the end of the show. But
I know, I just got in from work. I didn't know about this until now.
Okay, well, look, I will gladly have you on. We can have you come on and talk about your experiences, you know, your podcast and everything that you do, if you're all right with that.
Yeah, an interview with my acting and stuff like that?
Sure.
Yeah, sure, just let me know. Hit me. I guess you'll be talking to Derek, and then Derek can contact me about it.
Certainly. I would love to have you on.
Okay.
All right, man. Thank you.
Talk.
So we look forward to certainly having him come on the show here in the near future. But to finish up really quickly on Final Exam, one interesting bit of historical note. I have a good friend of my sister's and mine lives down in Columbia, South Carolina. The interesting note is Final Exam was shot in Shelby, North Carolina, and there are many ties to the studios and things to go along with that as well. If you want to talk about the one golden scene in the film, and I know I can hear Mitch pissing his pants right now when I say this, was there is one particular scene where one of the young lady's frat boyfriend is tied to a tree in a hazing ritual because he's giving up his pledge pin. And as the young girl is going through the lobbies and through the dorms and everything, she, in mid-stride, is probably two knuckles deep in her butthole digging something out. And then she later, with the same hand, opens up a pack of gum and eats gum and makes funny faces like the gum stinks. But, you know, there are some degrees of hilarity. Like I said, it's not the worst film. And if you're looking for a gory slasher with a lot of elements that you remember fondly from the 80s. This film is a little bit on the lighter end of that. I would rate the film about 3.5-4 stars in terms of that. I know it was not the director's intention to make a gore-soaked film, but in this case, I feel like it probably would have helped the project a little more. On Scream Factory's end, of course, the technical end is absolutely amazing. You know, the film looks good, the sound is good, the interview segments and the commentary are informative for the film and gives you just a little bit more insight into everything. Overall, on Scream Factory's end, I would give the disc about a 7 on their end. And, you know, and it's more of a combination. Like I said, not every film can be a 5-star film. And, you know, I give the directors credit for trying. Like I said, there are elements of the film that are strong, such as the structural narrative and getting to know the characters. But I am interested in doing a little bit more background on this, and you will see a feature article on Final Exam up on Horror Society in the near future. But we're up against the clock, ladies and gentlemen. It's the end of the evening. I would like to say thank you to all of my guests that came on this evening. Of course, we have to thank the great Derek Young for coming on to speak about his film Psychotic State. Let's not forget Michael Dautry coming on for speaking about Z-Con. We also want to say thank you to our friend Kelly out at Metal Blade for sending along all the fine metal we got. And thank you to the Tom Chen out at Shout and Scream Factory for sending us a Final Exam. Next week's going to be a special show. Trust me, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have a little bit of a history lesson. So look forward to that. And we're going to slide into the last song in our Metal Blade Spotlight for the evening. The name of this band is Powerwolf. The name of the CD is The History of Heresy 1. The name of the song is Montecore. And until next week, ladies and gentlemen, rest in peace.